So let's get started. So I am going to be talking about some techniques and just some fun things to do. And the material I'll be referring to is Magic House. And we have a three-year curriculum that spans, 3 years so that you can have, your Nensho, Nenchu, Nencho kids all in one class for 3 years, which is very it's a very good thing for that age, because it's sometimes difficult to make different levels and schedules for that age of kids. So we're looking to try and solve that problem by having imaginative play. And imaginative play is very good because it is a very context rich environment, and that can really help kids who are not at the same level to enjoy the same content. So that's what we're working on. So this is Jimmy, one of our characters. Just thought I'd introduce you. So first thing is an important thought to have, and that is, how do children play? So do they play like this? No, they don't. Well, some do, but that's an exception. I've been beaten before in a very competitive game of poker by a four-year-old, but anyways. So in my thoughts, kindergarten children play more like this. And so this is imaginative play. And so a lot of times we've kind of been handed down a tradition of how we view kindergarten lessons. And a lot of times we look to card games, bingo, and just some kind of what do they call go fish and things like that. We also do single grammar pattern games, like some kind of a basketball game or like a hammer game, and all of these are designed to have movement, some rhythm, some kind of a fun goal built in, so that children will practice vocabulary or grammar patterns, right? And these are all really good, very useful. And so what I'm trying to propose today is that there is a next stage that is beyond that. And that is the final stages, which is imaginative play. And that's my feeling is that that's the most natural way that kids play. So when we arrive in a teaching position for the first time, everybody always hears this phrase at the beginning, children learn through play. This is so important. Just remember that children learn through play. And so then we see our the other teachers that we're working with, and they're playing these like card games, or they're playing these single grammar pattern games. So I've been really working hard to get to this point where we can do imaginative play in an EFL environment, which is really hard. And it's hard because the kids, once they get into such a natural state of playing, they tend to jump into Japanese. And so they'll start, just talking. And so it's very challenging to set up the environment so that kids stay in English and they don't jump into Japanese. So I'm going to be looking at different ways that we can build towards making that happen successfully. So what's first? Well, this is the part that, you can skip if you want to, because it's kind of like a science-based, like a researchy type thing. And if you're an intuitive type teacher who just has a good sense of what kids love to do and how the kids love to play, you can just go with your gut on that. So that's this is just what I do, because I want to have something to refer to. So I use when I was making these books, I used the Dolch word list. Okay, and so this is basically one page of the list, but it's basically a list of the most frequently used words by native speaking children. And so what we did was we took this list, we reverse engineered it, and we put all the words into our stories, so that we wanted to make sure that our students are learning and being exposed to the words that are most used by native speaking children so that they can speak like native speaking children. Now, when I say speak like native speaking children, what I mean specifically is that they will be able to use the English that they have in a natural way. Obviously, you know, with once a week English classes, we're not going to be able to get our kids to be completely bilingual. The volume of exposure that is necessary for that is just not possible in a once a week a kaiwa. But we can get some pretty cool results by being focused and using effective techniques. So now, a couple of years ago, about 3 years ago, Dr. Charles Brown and Dr. Brent Culligan created the new Dutch word list. And I helped them a little bit on the qualitative analysis of this list. So they did all the smart things. And I did now how would a regular teacher use this list? All that kind of stuff. So they're the smart guys. I'm the fun guy. So that list is a little different. A lot of the words are similar because the Dutch word list, it's been used for 70 years and it was pretty good for its time, but there are different words that are in the upper, the higher frequency area. So I'm making adjustments based on the new list, which is based on, they've used modern research techniques and stuff to make that. So it's a very good list. So what is the basic recipe for creating and facilitating the imaginative play for kindergarten children? So what I'd like to do is I have simple games that practice language, which is good news because we all do that already. So do keep doing what you're doing with these kind of games, and songs that contain language that's needed for the imaginative play. So these are also things that we probably do already now, like songs that would be instead of, so for example, songs that are less than useful would be something like London Bridge is falling down. I don't want to live in a country where bridges fall down very often. I don't want to need to use that language, right? So though that language is not, it's not very useful, I do like to play some of those songs, but that's more to create a cultural bridge so that when our Japanese students get older and they make friends in America, they hear London Bridge, they're both like, oh, natsukashi, that's been so long since I've heard that song. It's a more of a cultural gap than a useful language gap. So songs that contain language that are needed, for example, do you want the cookie? Do you want the cookie? Do you want the cookie? Yes, please. That's useful language. So that's very good, those type of songs. And then a context-rich situation. If the children don't understand what's going on, they're definitely, they're going to switch to Japanese because they'll want to try to figure out what's happening. So some of my favorite songs and the best music that I've ever heard in my life is from Fun Kids English and then from Maple Leaf. So these guys, they are so good. Their music is so good, but the way the language is built into the songs is also like very, very thought out. And so you'll find if you use some of these songs that for better or for worse, they get stuck in your head. And that means they also get stuck in their kid's head. Now, we at Not House Education Magic House, we also make songs which for worse, get stuck in your head. So they're not quite as good, but we use some language that's a little more rare for EFL songs. We have some past tense type songs that are just not out there, but they're not as good. I'd prefer Fun Kids English and Maple Leaf, but anyways, I had to make them. I had to. So here's a sample of a simple game that is somewhat student-centered. So this is just to show you how to sort of set up a game with a with a 1-2 language target game. And what we want to try to do is set the game up so that by the end of the game, the kids are able to kind of play it on their own without the instructor involved. So this is the Are You a Sharp game. And this is, the target language is obviously, are you something? So, you know, they would be are you a doctor or are you a something or are you a, you know, student in this school or whatever. It's just a useful grammar point. But we want to teach it in a really fun way. So here's a game called Are You a Shark? And so the kids all stand, excuse me, I'm going to start that one more time. Can you see the full screen? There should be some kids, little kids standing to the right. And I think I myself cannot see the full screen. So I'm going to move this over here. Move everybody. Okay, great. So get the kids all standing to one side of the room. And then on the other side of the room, obviously, the first time you do it would be, you know, you would do it yourself to model the game. And then you would replace yourself with one of the more confident students. So the kids would all take a step towards the confident student. The confident student would have a set of flashcards, which would be sea animals. They would have some friendly sea animals. And then the last one would be some like a scary sea animal, like a shark. So all the kids take a step forward and they say, are you a shark? And then the kid on the other side would flip it and say, no, I'm a seal. And they turn it around again. And then they get closer. Are you a shark? No, I'm an octopus. So the great thing about this game is it's very similar to a tag or a hide and seek type game. And so what's good about those type of games is that kids, they play those games naturally. They want to play them. So when they're sitting by themselves in the park, they're like, what should we do? Oh, why don't we, let's play tag or let's play hide and seek. So these are games that you could pretty much play every week. And the kids would still pretty much enjoy it. I.e., they would be practicing language in a very fun way, and they wouldn't feel tired of it, right? So as they move closer to the student, they get more and more like, and then as they get closer, then it's the last one would be obviously, are you a shark? Yes. And then the student who is the shark, they kind of chase everybody, but once they touch the wall, they're safe. And so let's take a look at how that looks in the classroom. Yeah, so there we go. So the kids are all sort of speaking on their own. They're using the target language and it's very fun. So this is one of those, it's just a game where I have to like literally just say, okay, sorry, no more, because they keep requesting it. And even I had to cut the video for time, but even part of the other students who were, they were waiting for the child to choose his animals. And then while they were waiting, they all started playing by themselves. And they were like, are you a shark? No, I'm a seal or whatever. So it's a very good type of game to get to practice single and one or two grammar patterns that fit well together. Okay. So then talking about songs, okay? So what I'm gonna start to do now is work towards an activity that uses past tense for kindergarten children. Now, a lot of times, you know, when I've been in training, people, I've been actually told, like, stay away from past tense. You can't explain it. They won't understand it. But if you have children, you will know that one of the most used grammar patterns is the past tense, where their kids are like, mommy, I drank my juice. Hey, daddy, I drank it. Daddy, I drank it. Daddy, did you hear me? I drank it. Yes, I heard you. So they're always telling you about their experiences and what happened with their lives. And so past tense, they can use past tense, just that they can't understand the abstract concept of grammatical explanation. So all we got to do is make an activity that they're very familiar with. So we have what we call change of state flashcards. So basically what they are is on one side, for example, there is a plate of eggs. On the other side, there's a plate with eaten eggs. So they're almost gone, but you could still tell there's some eggs there. And so it's a change of state. So though, you know, our kindergarten children, they're going to say like, you know, kino no kino no kino no kino no kino. So they don't have a concrete understanding of time, but they do understand when something has changed, and that they have a very clear understanding of that. So if we set up situations that have that built into it, our students can use past tense in a way that is natural to them. As I talked about, you're all muted. We want to add a game that has simple patterns. Then we want to have some songs. So here's a couple of songs that build towards this game. So here's the first one. It's part of one of the stories.
I want to be a seal. I want to be a seal. Swim, swim like a seal. Swim, swim like a seal. Oh no, there's a shark. Let's get out of here. Swim, swim like a seal. 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 Phew, we're safe.
Yeah. So some of the key points for that song. And so I wrote that song, and the reason I wanted to have that particular song is because it has both the proper grammar, but it also has the way that we say it sometimes when we're talking quickly. So they said, I want to be a seal, and then I want to be a seal. And so they can hear both versions, because children will all, you know, they're probably going to be saying, you know, I want to be a seal. I want to be a this. I want to be a that. So that's one aspect, is we've added two versions of the language. One is the more often natural used language. It's a game like song where the kids are, you know, they're, sorry, this is not very cool, but it's like, I want to be a seal. I want to be a seal. Swim, swim like a seal. Swim, swim like a seal. Then we take out the shark flashcard, and then all the students will try to swim away from the shark. So they're like, swim, swim like a seal. Swim, swim like a seal. So actually the kids all say, oh no, there's a shark. Let's get out of here. And then swim, swim like a seal. Swim, swim like a seal, blah, blah, blah. And so we run away. And then we do it again for, you know, swim, I want to be a fish. I want to be a fish. So there's also repetition built in there. So it has a game-like sort of runaway from the shark atmosphere. So it's really, really fun. But what we want them to do is come out of that thing, being able to choose, who do you want to be? Because that's a real important part of imaginative play. I want to be mommy. I want to be daddy. I want to be such and such and so and so. So we wanted to have that part. So the next song is a song that has the past tense part of it built in. Okay. And so this one. We have a little dance. I won't do it.
You ate my rice, you ate my eggs, you ate my toast, and I like that one the most. You drank my juice, you drank my milk, you drank my tea, you didn't leave anything for me. I am so hungry.
And it goes on, but it's basically just a repetition of that. So when we set up the song, we use our change of state flashcards, and we have our bad dog character come in and yum 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 yum, and he eats the eggs and the rice. So that our students, we kind of do it like a magic trick, and so we have the bad dog comes in, and we flip him in front of the eggs side of the card, and we make him eat like yum, 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 and then we flip the whole thing this way so the eggs are eaten, and the kids are all like, "Whoa, hey, so they get pretty excited about that. Eventually they figure it out, but the first impression is always a really fun one. Needless to say, the kids are they're singing the song, "You ate my eggs, you ate my rice," so they're getting a lot of practice, and they know what they're saying, basically, right? Based on the setup of the song. Okay, so let's take a look at what the game looks like. So first, we want to become something. We want to become a character. So first, it's a very good idea for the instructor to model the language in a way that doesn't feel like modeling. I always pretend that I'm thinking, and I'm not sure what do I really want here? And so by doing that, it really just takes away this sense that I want you to say this. I want you to say this, because that's kind of feels kind of uncomfortable. Why is the teacher so pressured? So I pretend that I'm the one that's thinking. So I'm like, I want to be, I want to be a cow. Oh, I don't know. How about you? And then I'll ask my students. So I've modeled it a few times, leaving the end open for substitution on their part. So then, you'll have one or two of the competent students. They'll jump in and they'll be like, "I want to be a dog. I want to be a cow." And once one or two students jump in, they say, "I want to be a dog," and they grab the card. Then all the other kids, they'll start jumping in and trying to choose a card, because they want the card that they want. So it's a very good way to encourage the use of that language. So this is really amazing, and it's a good indicator of how incredible the power of children's imagination is. When I first played this game, I didn't have the children become animals. I just had them stay as themselves. And so this game, what it is that one student will close their eyes and look away, and then I'll choose two students to come and quote unquote eat the eggs. So they'll come in, they'll pretend to eat the eggs, flip the card, and then they'll go back. And then the student who has their eyes closed, they'll open their eyes and try to guess who ate the eggs. So they would be saying, "Hey, you ate my eggs." "No, Hana, you ate my eggs." "Toshi, you ate my eggs." And so they'll try to find who ate their eggs using the past tense in that sense. But what happened was that the kids were refusing to eat the eggs because it was not the right thing to do. So they were saying, "Kani no tamago tametara dami da yo." And so they were very serious about it. So what I did was I took the characters from the story who actually did eat the eggs and stuff, and then we had the kids become those characters. So we let them choose. So they all say, "I want to be a cat, I want to be a dog, I want to be a cat, I want to be a dog." And then we have the student say, "Don't eat my eggs, okay?" And then they close their eyes. "I'm sleepy." And then we have the two kids come and eat the stuff, and then everybody says, "Wake up, please." And then they wake up, and then they react, and they go to the students and try to find their eggs. "So you ate my eggs." "No." "You ate my eggs." "No." "You ate my eggs." "Yes, I'm sorry." "That's okay. I have more eggs." Chop, 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 chop. And so they go back and pretend to cook more eggs and flip it over again. So few key points here. Like I set it up so that there's no kind of like negative ending to the thing. So that's one important thing. But also, I've built in language, other useful language that's kind of hard to teach. So for example, "I'm sorry." That's kind of, it's hard to teach that because you kind of have to make kids do bad things to each other. Okay, punch Toshi and say sorry. Okay, "Oh, I'm sorry." Or punch Hana, say sorry. Okay, or there has to be something to apologize for. So it's kind of hard to set up a situation where they say, "I'm sorry," right? So there we are. So we have that situation. So So then we switch and kids will take turns being the animal that eats the food and the person who's sleeping and that kind of stuff. Yeah. So, sorry. And so we can kind of set this up so that the kids are kind of playing on their own. And it's also good because it's a game that that lower level kids can just copy the higher level kids. So the lower level kids would be, they would be able to just be like a Japanese student were they to go to a kindergarten in America. And in America, they would just, the parents would be like, hey, this is great. Just throw their kid in a kindergarten and hope, in a year they'll be speaking. And so that happens actually. They actually do get able to speak quite well. And that's because they can watch all the other kids interacting with the context-rich environment. So it's clear to them, they can get what they want. And so you can also, if you have longer lessons and more time with your kids, you can also make this into a craft. And so I'll just show you some of those. I don't do this. I only do this for summer school, some kind of special events. And so just a minute. So this is the thing I'm talking about. I don't do this in my regular classes because sometimes it could just take too much time, more time than we have. So we would do this for summer school or something like that. Yeah. So the kids can choose which animal they want to be, and you can do a coloring version of this, or you can just do a cut and paste version or whatever, but the kids can actually put them on their heads and become the animal. And then it's kind of like a take home fun thing for the kids. Now that's getting the kids to this level, it obviously can be challenging if you're not working towards that continuously. But some things that can help are home study materials. So if they have something like these kind of talking flashcards, I'll just quickly show you.
Toys. Train. Train. It's a train. Top. Top. It's a top.
Yeah. So just have some kind of a talking flashcard type thing where it's fun music and it has rhythm and kids can be exposed to the vocabulary. When I say vocabulary in this case, I'm just kind of meaning like single words, probably nouns. If we spend all of our lesson time just teaching nouns, it'll be very challenging for us to get our kids speaking naturally in the end. So here's another craft-based imaginative play activity. And so what this one is basically just we take origami style paper. This one we have a printable one that you can print on A4. And basically, we cut out the train, the doll, the robot, and the skipping rope or the jump rope, and then kids can choose what they want for. If it's a birthday party type activity, that's fine. If it is if it's like a Christmas, it's around Christmas time, it's a great call. So we can ask, what do you want for, let's use Christmas, for example, what do you want for Christmas? And they can choose, I want a doll, I want a train, I want a robot. They could actually choose what they want, and then they can take it and they glue it inside. And then they fold the sides so that it actually opens. So when we say open your present, and we actually do, we combine these type of imaginative play activities with story TPR. So in for us, it is, go to the bedroom, sleep, wake up, go to the living room, open the door, look at the presents, pick up a present, open the present. And so we do that for four weeks or so. And pretty much at the end of that 4 weeks, they're able to say that all by themselves. And then when we get to the Christmas tree, we have these crafts that they've already prepared or that we've made together. And then they could actually open their own presents on Christmas morning. And so, yeah, so they choose their toy and then we open the present. And then we can say, what did you get? I got a doll. I got a train. I got a robot. And they can actually use, the prep preparation for that. So what do you want? I want. And then once they receive it, they can use the past tense. So I got this, I got that. Yeah. So that's our thing. So then here we can add some, you know, relatively challenging language that is not, it's easy for kids to understand what they're saying. So what did you get for Christmas? I got a doll. Are you happy? Yes. Yay. So this is just this one here, it's not something that I've been able to get to the point where the kids are all doing it on their own, but I do this to expose them to more words on the high frequency word lists, the new Deutsch word list and the Deutsch word list that I'm using. So we'll have some cards here and they have presents on the back. So it's, who is the red present for? For Kana. Who is the green present for? For Charlie. Who is the yellow present for? For Yumiko. Yay. What's this? It's a present. What color is it? It's red. Is it for Kota? No, it's for Kana. Now, of course, before these activities, I'll have already done songs like, you know, what color is it? It's red. It's yellow. Da, 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 you know, those ones. So that they're, hi. Sorry, I thought I heard something. So no, it's for Kana. Is it from daddy? No, it's from mommy. Should I eat it? No, open it. Okay. And then they open it. Wow, it's a doll. And we use this to play like a circle type game where each of the student is going to get one present. Wow, it's a doll. So this present, let's say that a boy, Kotaro opened this present, then I would say, wow, it's a doll, right? And I'll indicate it's actually a van, but I'll make a mistake on purpose. Wow, it's a doll. And then all the students, you know, they jump in, that's not a doll, and it's a van. So just continually adding you know, lots of very useful language that kids use very, very often. And then finally, you know, Kana got the van. And Kana, are you happy? No, why not? I want a doll. Now, obviously, there's, you know, there are some you know, girls and boys, they'll both want different things. I've had boys who wanted dolls, girls who wanted vans, blah, blah, blah. This particular sample has a girl named Kana who actually wanted a doll. And so she said, this is where this came from, is that she actually said, I'm not happy, I want a doll. Okay. Yeah. So then what's great about that is it sets up a situation that allows kids to work on problem solving. So one student has a doll, one student has a van, and they each want different things. So we can say, okay, what should we do? You know, Kana has a van, Kotaro has a doll. So overtly think and just think. And then you'll start to see kids trying to like suggest things, and they'll say like, doll to Kana, van to Kotaro. And then we would recast the language back to them, and we would say, oh, I see. So give the doll to Kana and give the van to Kotaro? Yes. Okay, let's do it. And then they can change, and then, yeah, then are you happy? Yes. I'm going to skip this because this is just a quick activity where kids can choose their own clothing, blah, blah, blah. This is a song. I'm going to skip it. So I'll quickly, and the reason I'm moving a little fast now, because I want to try to get to some of that content for Jess. Phonics in imaginative play, you want to expose the kids to...
And...
B. B. B.
Yeah.
So again, using home study, some type of home study material, so that the kids can be exposed to the stuff before they get to you, so that it makes your job a lot easier to teach them those really simple things, which pretty much anyone could teach them, and then let you, as the native speaker, work on the higher level, more challenging language stuff. So this is just a quick game. It's like building phonics into a small, very light imaginative play. So we have strawberries, which are red. We have tomatoes, which are red. We have a piece of toast with some red jam on it. And it has an S, which is the s-s-s. So the kids would need to know that that the S says s, and they would need to be able to recognize that the strawberries start with a s sound and not a t, strawberries. So this activity is kind of like a little matching activity where kids would match the jam to the flavor. So what kind of jam is this? It's strawberry jam. And so then they take the strawberries and match them up. I'll show you what that looks like in the next slide. But basically, this one is just that's a good cheer. And then, you know, the key here is having two of the exact same colors so that they have to think. So persimmons and oranges, what kind of jam is it? It's orange jam, a little bit of a stretch there, but yep. And then, is he gonna cheer? No, okay. So here's this is a quick one to show you the story TPR that we use to make the jam. So we all get the kids, let's all stand up, let's go to the kitchen, open the fridge, take out the strawberries. Take out the strawberries, cut the strawberries, mix the strawberries, get a pot, cook the strawberries. These are just cute images, but we actually just acted out with the kids. And make jam, eat the jam. So we would be acting it out to rhythm with the students. So it's go to the kitchen, open the fridge, take out the strawberries, cut the strawberries, mix the strawberries, get the pot, cook the strawberries, make jam, eat the jam, yum, yum, yum. And so we do that kind of thing where the kids are, you know, after, you know, 3, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, they're able to kind of say this, making jam process. And then we would have a little jam. Someone becomes the kids. And then we say, okay, are you hungry? Yes. Do you want some jam? Yes, please. What kind? Watermelon jam, please. Kiwi jam, please. So then this child over here, they would take the jam splotch and then the kiwi toast, and they would put them together and give it to the child, who would probably be more likely like a lower level child. So they could just say very simple one word type things. Are you hungry? Yes. Do you want some jam? Yes. What kind? Kiwi jam, please. Okay, here you are. Thank you. So it's a very good balance between a skilled student and then a newer lower level student. So both students can have activities that are at their level and they feel challenged, but not pressured or too challenged, depending on what type of student they are. And so that's a simple one that will lead towards a more sophisticated one, which is shopping. And so for the shopping one, we want to get them to become someone. So we would say, okay, I want to be daddy. No, I want to be mommy. I'm not sure. How about you? And then the student would say, I want to be mommy. Okay. So you can be mommy. And then they would do their little shop, fruit shop. And, you know, the kid, the child running the shop would say, you know, how are you? Or are you hungry? So are you hungry? Yes. Which one do you want? A strawberry, please. How many? And 4, please. Here you are. And it's important to know, like, having realia to use is good, but it's really difficult to prepare so many objects. So we just use flashcards. And so I'll hold the flashcard and students will take just imaginary strawberries and give them out. So 4, please. Okay, here you are. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just totally imaginary. So know that it's just as good just using imaginary things. And so they give the strawberries. And then how much? That's 4 coins, please. Or 3? 3. Okay. So we use these coins here. I think they sell various types of these kind of coins anywhere, any kind of coins, or even you can make your own paper money or whatever. For the older students in elementary school, we sometimes make wallets. So this is a wallet. They can fold it up. It looks pretty amazing, if you'll ask me. And they have, you know, they can keep they can keep, you know, money inside. So yeah, it's actually, if you look at the money, who's on that money? Yahoo, that's me. Anyways, so that's there's different things you can do to help sort of make the imaginative world pretty super fun. This is an activity for elementary school kids where they would choose their shop, and then they can actually write out the items in their shop onto this thing, and then they play shop just like I just suggested. So this is a quick video which shows these guys doing imaginative play. And
okay, hello. So do you want a big chair or a small chair?
Big chair, please.
Okay, what color do you want?
Yeah, orange, please.
Okay, here you are.
That's not orange.
Oh, I'm sorry. Here you are.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so I'm sleepy. I'm going to the kitchen. Yes, I'm sleepy.
Go to the bedroom.
What's that?
Go to the bedroom.
Go to the bedroom?
Yes.
Okay. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night. Watch out. Watch out.
What's that?
Watch out.
Watch out.
Watch out. A spider. Watch out.
Sit down, please.
Spider.
What's that?
Spider.
There's a spider?
Yes.
Where? What's that?
Under the pillow.
Under the pillow?
Yes.
Oh no, I will check.
I can catch.
What?
I can catch the spider.
You can catch the spider?
Yes.
Okay, well, catch him together. Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1, go.
Just look how into it they are, like they're totally in that world of just okay. Sort of, there was actually a real spider, or a real bug that they found.
Threw it away. Let's put him out the window, okay? Out the window.
Opening the window, yeah, so that's that. And, you know, we got all kinds of worksheets, blah, 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 blah. So that is, I am running out of time. So, Jess, I think I might have to come back for that next time, because just 1 second here. Doesn't seem to be downloading. Oh, here it is. Okay. Yeah, I guess I'll have to do it next time. But basically, quick idea for you. For like, let's say you're doing the gingerbread man story. What you could do is take some little gingerbread man. This is what one of the activities that we did for that one is we made an oven, and then we made some gingerbread man. We photocopied them so that they had a dark brown side, and then on the other side it was a light brown side, and then everybody, you know, got to make a little gingerbread man using body parts and blah, 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 blah. And then, so then when they put them in the oven, put them light side up, and then we count to 10. Okay, let's wait. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then ding, and then the oven opens up, and we flip it so that when we take it out, there's brown, the cookies are brown on the other side. But you want to also have, you know, TPR that's built into that. But basically, it's sort of like incorporating some imaginative play with making the process of sort of making the gingerbread man there. But I have that was a 40-minute presentation that I did on that. So I can probably do that next time for you. Yep. Okay. So let's go into questions. Greg, okay, so so I'm just going to go quickly over the questions. I feel it has been difficult for me to incorporate songs in our classes because we are not using a guitar, music player, etc., and just using our voices. A lot of ESL songs feel awkward without any background music. Do you have any advice for this? That's great. It's, yeah, I totally get you on this. I would say the first major, the you know, the big point would be is just have fun with it. Kids care less than you think. And what they do care though is if you feel awkward or nervous, they definitely will notice that. So if you are just have, you know, say, forget it, I'm going to have fun with this thing. And then just kind of like try to just sing in a, with a fun, just have fun. And then that'll make it a lot easier to do that. The other thing too, is to change the song instead of trying to sing it as it is, like with a, you know, beautiful singing voice, you could just clap it out. So whatever that song might be. So like, do you want the cookie? Do you, instead of, do you want the cookie? 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 Yes, please. Just a clapping version of the songs. So those are things that you can do. Other things that you can do, I don't know why you're not allowed to use music players, but there's always going to be some situation where it's going to happen. But there are some very, very small music, like speakers, Bluetooth speakers. And, you know, if you put your music into a file like Dropbox or Google, you can, you know, play from your iPhone onto a speaker. So, but it seems like your situation is you simply can't. So I would say using rhythm clapping with the same words of the song can be a great, but mainly just have fun. Make sure that you're not showing that you're feeling awkward. Could you give us a little peek at what's inside the storybooks? Oh dear, should have seen that one earlier. How many times did you practice with the kids in that last video? So that last video, that's a good question. Thank you for asking. So that one there, we did that. So they've been studying with me for 2 years and 8 months. And I wish I could show you a video of kids who've been with me for 8 months. They're pretty good too, but these guys, it's been 2 years and 8 months. So we practiced, I would say 8 weeks in total for that particular video. But it's, you know, when you teach high frequency sight words, it means that you're using words that are used in so many different situations. So kind of everything that we do, even if it's different content from what's in the video, it's still useful for these kind of things. So it's not like we've just practiced 8 times. It's just the totality of all of the practicing that we're doing that gets them to that level. I'll try to quickly show you what's inside.
Scott, you're running out of time, actually. Could you please answer the last question? No problem.
So last question.
A couple more I've just put in there, Scott.
Okay. Do you read the book to the class first? Yes. I read the book to the class first. I'll do that basically two times. And then after that, they don't really need it anymore. How can we access the digital activities? So David Paul is going to put up a link to our website. If you go to the contact page and just send a quick message saying, I saw your seminar, I want the goods, give me some downloads. Then we can just send you some of the flashcards that I used today in this presentation, So thank you very much. So if you want some of these, like the toast, the phonics toast, some of the flashcards, the change of state flashcards, just send us a message. In the contact page on the website, and that's it. I think I've got all the questions that are there except for showing the pages of the books, and I'll just quickly shoot.
There's one last question there, Scott. Where to get the flashcards?
So all the flashcards can be downloaded from the digital, from the website. So this is just one quick story, looks kind of like this. This one's actually our the elementary school books. But yeah, if you go to the website link, if anything that you can't find regarding like flashcards and all the materials and stuff, send us a message in the contact page of the website, and then we'll share those over. Yeah, and we can share those materials. Yes, we will share.
I don't know if you've got time, but there's two more quick ones there.
Okay, what at the end? I am using the Magic House series. Thank you for the great product. The videos are helpful. I found at the end of the workbook, there are a lot of vocabulary that come up in the summary pages. How do you teach so many words with once a week classes? So to help with that, you just we have all the talking flashcards. So just message me. Just message me in and we'll send you the talking flashcard links. They're on YouTube, so they're all free. So you could just send all, what you do is you let your students go over the talking flashcards prior to the lessons, so they kind of come already knowing all of the words.
Maybe you could just put your website in the chat there, Scott.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think we need to stop now because of the.
Okay. Sorry. Yep. But Jess, I'll give you that. I'll go over that. I'll do another seminar when for just other materials that are so the big hits out there. And that helps. Okay.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Well, anyways, thank you, everyone, for coming today.